السلام علیکم ورحمۃ اللہ وبرکاتہ. حضرت امیر المومنین ایدہ اللہ تعالیٰ بن نسل عزیز از ناؤ کمنگ فار ہز پروگرام ملاقات. ٹوڈے ہی ول بی میٹنگ اے ڈیلیگیشن آف بنگلہ احمدیس. السلام علیکم. السلام
علیکم. اپنے کیمن آچھن؟
امی بھلو آچھے الحمدللہ. اپنا دعا
دوشین. السلام علیکم. آپ نے نام کی؟
محیدین زبیر.
محیدین زبیر. اچھا اپنے باڑی کو تھا
تمہارا دو جونی
I know these two young boys. I met them before. Yes. And God has blessed them with very, shall we say, very rich voice and a charming voice. It's very...
Alhamdulillah.
Have you heard them sing?
Yes, yes, sir. Earlier in Bangladesh also.
Achha.
And here also.
Quite right. Here as well.
Yes.
So, in during this program, I would like them to sing a few songs. Or have you ever composed a Bangla song yourself?
Yes.
Yes.
You say yes, they didn't understand it.
Yes.
You did? On Ahmadiyyat?
On Ahmadiyyat Bengali Nazam.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
Did you make one? Do you remember one or did you make it yourself?
Not yet thoroughly. Not yet thoroughly.
What do you mean by not yet thoroughly?
they are trying to compose, Huzur.
But he says one Bengali Nazam. What is he talking about?
Actually,
one of you is half an hour older than the other. Is he the older?
Yes,
that's right. Yes.
So we are doing some Urdu nazam in here, which is we are trying to already record two of those, and another four is
both sing together in duets. Is that right?
Yes.
One after the other.
Yes.
Or together.
One line is
sung by him and the other line is sung by you.
Yeah.
Give us a demonstration, please.
I'm doing this Urdu one.
Okay. Whatever you do. Both, are you ready?
Yes,
I'm
good,
ready.
Good.
Jamal-o-Husn-e-Quran-e-Noor-e جانے ہر مسلمان ہے.
لولی ہے
جمال و حسن قرآن نور جانے ہر مسلمان ہے. قمر ہے چاند اوروں کا ہمارا چاند قرآن ہے. قمر ہے چاند اوروں کا ہمارا چاند قرآن ہے. جمال و حسن قرآن نور جانے ہر مسلمان
ہے. Go on.
Any further?
Don't stop.
I wrote it in my own paper. And then go to
where are your own papers then?
It's huh? In my file.
And you left your file home?
Yes.
Oh no. Tell somebody to bring me up. Where is Wahid? Perhaps he could write in Bangladesh language. Inquire about Wahid and bring, call him to come in and join us.
Wahid is sick.
Achha.
Se Bangla mein wo likh lega.
In the meantime, we talk of other things, okay? Tell me, do you have any questions to ask me today?
Yes.
On behalf of the Bangladeshi Jamaat?
Yes.
Which? Who will start? You are the moderator, you better begin. Okay, take over.
Thank you, Huzur Akdas, for providing this great opportunity in this Mulaqaat occasion. Huzur Akdas, you remember Bangladesh?
Of course.
Your Honor had been kind enough to pay visit to Bangladesh many times in the past. And in the background of Your Honor's past experience and the present religious situation now obtaining in that country, what would be your kind advice towards the leadership and the people of that country, Bangladesh?
Well, first of all, let me remind you that I visited your place as well.
Yes.
You were a young boy, a student.
Yes.
And you visited your home only for a short while.
A short while.
And we happened to meet there for the first time.
Yes.
Is that right? Do you remember?
Yes, it is right.
When was it, in the 60s?
In 1960,
yes,
possibly.
Yes, in
60s. I was a student of MA. Economics at Dhaka University.
MashaAllah, you are keeping good health.
By the grace of Allah.
Even at that time, you were an MA student and still is, MashaAllah, quite young and strong. And
thank you. Aapki dua.
Alhamdulillah. And how's everybody at home? Tell me about the news, latest news from home.
By the grace of Allah, everyone is keeping well. My mother is reaching around 90.
I remember she was not very old, but advanced in age. And your father?
My father expired in Maulvi Badruddin Ahmad,
yes.
Marhum advocate. Mm. He died in 15th January 1985.
That's right. I remember it was reported to me from Bangladesh.
Yes.
And I heard it with deep sadness, because Maulvi Badruddin Sahib was very, very close to me, although there was such a difference of age. But we were very friendly. He used to attend all meetings at Dhaka, and
also
he was one of the most forward Ahmadis.
Yes,
very wise man as well.
He visited Qadian and Rabwa often, and he visited, and my mother also visited your house.
Would she be listening to this program? Do you think? Do they have antenna there at your home?
At Rangpur. Not yet, Huzur.
Not yet.
He has flown to Rangpur just before I left.
Somebody had written to her, and she could come and listen to you and me, could see her son, you know, participating in this meeting. She would have been so happy.
There is a program that Dish Antenna will be extended to Rangpur also, right. Huzur's
I think we'll repeat this program later on when you are ready.
Yes.
When your mother has got access to any dish antenna,
yes,
then let us know and we'll repeat this program.
Inshallah, okay. Huzur. I shall talk to National
Amir. What about your other sisters and brothers and everyone?
My advocate Abdul Khalik, he was in Dhaka. Now he's also at Rangpur. My youngest brother, Kaisar Alam, who visited Huzur here at London.
Yes, I know.
With his wife,
yes.
The daughter of Marhum Vizir Ali Sahab,
yes.
The General Secretary and the Naib Amir.
He was in the National Bank.
Renamed as Sonali Bank.
Yes.
Soneri.
Yes. Previously, it used to be National Bank.
National Bank.
After Bangladesh. I also visited his place.
Yes, Huzur. And my brother-in-laws are at Dhaka now. Vice Principal of the City College, Shah Mustafizur Rahman, who wrote various books and translated your lectures also.
He's a great author, mashallah.
Aapke dua.
He writes beautiful language, Bangla, and he's quite a scholarly person. He also wrote some books on comparative study on Islam and science and
other religions.
Yes, and other religions, of course. So
kindly pray for him.
Would he be on the television?
Yes, he is watching now.
I read your books with deep interest, and I'm very happy. You have a good command of English as well as Bangla. Of course, that's your language. And I hope you continue to write more and more, and inshallah Jamaat will benefit and the rest of the Bangladeshis also will benefit from your writings.
My wife and Waqfe, now the youngest child, mm-hmm. and your Sadar Murubbi Abdullah Wal Khan Chaudhry's only son, he is also Waqfe now. They are also attending.
Hazur Abul is your son-in-law, isn't
he? My brother-in-law. My wife's younger brother. My wife's younger brother.
Is that right? You are married to Dr. Abdul Samad's daughter?
Yes. Huh? Yes,
Hazur. Dr. Abdul Samad's daughter? Yes. I didn't know that.
So, mashallah. They conveyed, the Waqfe Nows conveyed, tell Hazur our salam. They could speak hardly.
Right.
They are only 4 years.
Good.
Kindly pray for them.
Dr. Abdul Samad is also very close to me. He's a very, very fine man indeed, exceptionally gifted by Allah in so many ways. He was a very close friend of late Sheikh Mujibur Rahman Sahib.
Yes, adjacent houses.
Adjacent. They were next door neighbors to each other. Yes. And my first and the only meeting, in fact, with Sheikh Mujibur Rahman Sahib took place at his house. And although Sheikh Sahib was very busy during this, and he was riding very high.
On the crest of popularity.
On the crest of his popularity.
Yes.
Yet he couldn't refuse Dr. Samad Sahib. And he came and gave me half an hour to begin with, I should say.
It continued, possibly.
And he said, I can only come to have breakfast with you. And during that period, whatever you want to say, I'll listen sympathetically. Then after half an hour was over, he wouldn't let me go. He said, all right, I'll cancel the other meeting. Let's continue. You know, the meeting continued for around four and a half hours. And he would not let me go. But yet I had to excuse myself because I had another meeting with Mr. Khundkar, Mushtaq Khundkar.
Khundkar Mushtaq Ahmad.
Is he alive? Or?
He is alive.
He's alive.
Ex-president. Subsequently, he became
exactly.
president of the country.
That's right. Yes, I know.
Yes.
Khundkar. And if somebody is listening to this program who knows Mr. Khundkar, convey my regards to him. We had a very good meeting together. You know, I went to explain things to them on behalf of Pakistan, which needed to be explained. And although they were in no mood whatsoever to listen sympathetically to these things, but I must say they were kind enough to me because I was not a political leader. So I went there in my individual capacity as a religious person, sympathetic to, of course, the cause of humanity, not to the cause of Bangladesh or any other, or Pakistan. So they understood the sincerity very well. And after a few exchanges of views, rather stiff from their side, they began to soften and thaw down. And ultimately, alhamdulillah, we had very good meeting, Mr. Khundkar as well.
Yes.
He had some misunderstandings regarding the policy of M.M. Ahmad. And when I explained these things to him, then he was surprised. And one thing I must say in favor of Bangladeshi temperament as whole, they may be very stiff to begin with, you know, strong in opposition. But somehow they have, you know, a soft point for logic.
Yeah.
If you're logical,
yes,
then they will not try to, you know, like some others do, indulge in useless, meaningless debate, knowing that they are wrong, then they wouldn't do that. Once they are convinced there is something in it, they would listen sympathetically, and they had courage enough to accept the defeat, the so-called defeat in that debate.
Arguments.
And but at the same time, the politicians were politicians, of course. I remember I met Mr. Sirajul Islam as well.
Sirajul Islam.
Is he still alive?
Yes, he's still alive.
Uh-huh. He used to be a very important member of Awami League at that time. And he used to be a link between Awami League and India in particular. So he was quite frank with me. I don't want to say everything which passed between us. But I remember the impression that he too was no exception to this general excellent character of Bangladesh. To begin with, he advocated very strongly why Bangladesh should be more friendly with India than Pakistan, etc. Bangladesh was yet not formed, you know. It was in the offing, but they knew. It was so positive that at that time they had already started referring to the country as Bangladesh. So I said, I listened to him sympathetically, and then I started talking to him of this and that, and I clarified myself. I said, look here, I'm not here as an advocate of Pakistan. I'm nobody in Pakistan. They would never think of sending me as an emissary. So if you think I'm a sort of agent, forget about it. They would not send an Ahmadi, you know. So having reassured him, then I touched upon the points he had raised. And, you know, in the end, he said that I think there is something in what you say, but it's too late. And exactly the same thing was said by Dr. Sheikh Mujib Rahman Sahib. At last he said, I'm sorry, I'll not be able to change my policy now. It's too late. But I agree with largely with the substance of what you have said. So that was my impression of Bangladesh, and it still is. I did not meet only the leaders. You know, I don't believe in meeting only a certain section of the society. Whenever I went to Bangladesh, I traveled far and wide, met the people at the grassroots, talked with rickshaw drivers, you know, and the farmers and the laborers, and sat with them. And most of my knowledge of Bangladesh grew from that, you know, grassroots level meetings. Because they are so simple, they do not have any affectations. What they feel, they tell. And there sometimes their expressions were very, very sharp. But sharp and, with a sharp tinge, of course, but so precise. They said their whatever they wanted to say in a short sort of expression they had invented themselves. You know, they were very proud of inventing new expressions and conveying things in a very special way so that their addressee would remember it and would be influenced. Somebody else's driver, was had a leaning towards left side. Particularly, I think he was impressed by Bhashani Sahib very much. So I inquired from him what he thought, what was his political view and philosophy, etc. I was surprised to learn the depth of his knowledge and understanding of politics. That is another thing about Bangladesh which impressed me so much. Ordinary people, you know, who appeared to be almost ignorant and illiterate, when you spoke with them, they spoke with full confidence. Politics they understand. There is no doubt about it. Everywhere, at every level, they understand politics. In our country, politics is sort of, you know, entrusted with the higher echelon of society. They have the full trust of the people in politics, so whatever they tell them, they follow. But not so in Bangladesh, no. They have to be individually convinced, you see. So I said, tell me in short, what is your philosophy? He said, philosophy very simple, no problem. Philosophy is big people, rich people. I said, you have chicken, hen, but give us egg. We only demand egg. You can have whole chickens and whole hens and everything, and cockerels. What do you like? But only let us have a little share in eggs.
Right.
How pathetically expressed, and how right he was. The common man was deprived of even eggs. They were also being consumed by the rich.
Yes.
I mean, that is his way of telling that the very basics of rights are denied us. The basic human rights of survival are denied us. That is what he wanted to express. And I traveled Bangladesh so much that so far I have not met any other Bangladeshi who has traveled so much as I have.
In Bangladesh.
Oh, in Bangladesh. From one end to the other, to Cox's Bazaar, Rangamati, and beyond to the...
Panchagar,
of course. And Sundarban. Sundarban. Oh.
Yes.
That's right. Sundarban, they are listening. Yeah, they have got a generator. So, assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Aapne keman aachen? Bhalo aachen? Ami bhalo aachi. Alhamdulillah. Convey my regards and love to all in Bangladesh. Tell the Sundarban people that I can't speak Bangladeshi well.
Huzur Akdas, Banglate, Amake Janata Bulachan, Bangladesher, Shabai Kitini, Salam Janachan, Emang Shubacha Janachan. হুজুর বলছেন যে আমি বাংলায় সঠিকভাবে বলতে পারি না, তুমি বলে দাও, আমি সেটা বলে দিলাম।
Everybody was so kind, so loving there, you know. And Shamsur Rahman sahib used to be the president. He is no longer alive.
He is marhum.
Marhum. He is a very fine man.
Great man.
Very great man indeed. And it was his efforts largely which bore fruit of such quick spread of Ahmadiyyat all around. A very scholarly person, and he was very highly respected in the whole area. Yes. Even those who opposed Ahmadiyyat, you know, they bowed their head to him in respect. Yes. For his past services and the...
He was chairman for a long time,
yes,
of the Union Council. And he set up schools and other institutions.
I mean, for his previous services, philanthropic services, etc., everybody respected him. So, when they heard, with this attitude of respect, naturally their hearts were already softened and they opened up to his logic as well. So one thing I must say, based on my experience of Bangladesh, as I have been telling you, that there is a great possibility, really indeed, of spreading the message of Ahmadiyyat in Bangladesh,
inshallah,
with two weapons, love and logic. They give in to love, and they give in to logic. It's impossible for Bangladeshis to resist these two things. You speak with love to them, and they want to shower their life on you. And you bow down, you know, you browbeat them, or try to look down upon them, and they would rebel against this. They wouldn't care whether small or weak or this. They're brave enough to sacrifice all for the sake of their honor. And this is the one thing which unfortunately was not understood by the politicians of Pakistan at that time. Repeatedly they made the mistake of browbeating them. And third thing, which is very important, is their love of the language. Every people love their language, but not like Bangladeshis. They love the language so much.
Right.
That, you know, it reminds me of my early childhood experience with birds. I'll tell you of that later, but I'll relate it. Those Ahmadi students who dedicated their lives, came from Bangladesh and stayed in Pakistan for some time, or previously in India, when they returned to Bangladesh, they thought their Bangladeshi was no longer that same pure language. Their accent was influenced, their pronunciation was influenced, their style of expression was changed, and they didn't approve of it. And they always said, this man, Bangla was good, but no longer. Only some exceptions were made, of course, I know. But after a few years back at home, they of course acquired the same quality of Bangla. But they were very sensitive to the quality of Bangla spoken there. And once it has even a slight flavor of some foreign hands, then they react against it. Now, the early experience of birds which has come to my mind is that when I was very fond of bird and fowling the nests and seeing the eggs, sometimes I picked up the eggs in my hands and saw the size and shape and then put it back. And I sometimes was horrified to see that the egg which had been touched by me was thrown out of the nest by the little wren, small, we call it piddi, in English is W-R-E-N, wren. So those wrens, a sort of piddi, they didn't like human touch. And they smelt the human flavors, or sense of, to them, the horrifying stink. And they threw the egg out of the nest. So similarly, the Bengalis, I think, are rather sensitive to the quality of Bangladeshi language. And if it has a foreign stench, as this, they wouldn't like it. So these three secrets, which I've learned from my tours, should be remembered by all who want to convey the message of Ahmadiyyat Islam to Bangladesh, not only to Muslims, but to Hindus, a large number of Hindus. And then there are Buddhists. You see, in Cox's Bazar area, in
Chittagong Hill
Tracts.
And Chittagong.
Yes, in Chakma Raja.
Chakma Raja.
I met him and the family members.
Raja Tridip Rai.
I think it was not he, it was his son or some prince,
yes,
whom I met there.
I see.
And there is a large number of such people living in the borders between Burma and Bangladesh. And they should be approached. They should be conveyed the message. So you should be broader in your outlook. And remember that with love and with persuasion, if you're well armed with logic, inshallah, Bangladesh will be won over.
Inshallah.
So, but prayer, of course, I must remind you.
Huzur se dua will be.
Without prayer, even the love is useless.
Yes, sir.
And that love works only with sincerity. And if you truly love a people and know that it is for their good, then automatically you must pray for them. So when you don't pray, that means your love lacks that much sincerity. And people understand this. You know, a superficial love does not produce the results which genuine, deep-seated love does. Deep-seated love is a very powerful weapon. So Bengalis particularly are prone to this, and I hope, inshallah, you'll be able to deliver the message with these three things: good language, love, and persuasion. With prayer, of course, right? And what else would you like to say?
May I bring out the question that in your such a vast experience...
I heard you.
Yes.
But I thought it would require an hour's lecturing, which I wanted to avoid. If you... I understood you very well, and I still understand what you meant, but to give an advice to all the politicians
and religious leaders
of public opinion, etc., I think this is not the right forum. But if you raise a particular issue, just point out a problem, then inshallah. Have you written it? No, they won't, but he does. They will lie down. If you, I tell you what, you better go out for a while, three of you. Give them papers to write their own.
In Bangla. You recite in Urdu?
You recite in Urdu slowly and make them understand.
He will put in Bengali. Yes,
okay. You will do for both?
No, one. One will do.
You can do it for yourself as well as you have to do it for himself.
Yes.
Two sheets are to be prepared.
One sheet will be enough.
No. I have seen that. Then you keep passing sheets and don't like.
Two sheets.
Two sheets and have your sheet before you. Okay?
Huzur Akdas, there may be a specific question that presently some mullahs are issuing fatwas on, say, the in Islam, women are not allowed to prosecute studies and higher studies particularly, and for work, whatever kind of, even teaching or other works, they should be kept in house, and so that they have a good sway over them. And also, due to their fatwa, some young women were hanged in some part of Sylhet.
Is that right?
Yes, by they were Sangasar type of thing.
Unbelievable.
They took the law in their own hands. There is a hue and cry, and government is also trying to contain them. And
but
intellectuals
you,
Ahmadis, are also.
Ahmadis scholars in particular should give full support to the sympathizers of the women who work for their liberation, emancipation from such stupid, non-tolerant clergy, which has no right to be so, because they're supposed to represent Islam, which is the kindest religion I have ever come across, the most kind religion, understanding very particularly towards women. The Islamic attitude is so benign and so wonderful and so respectful that in no other religion can you find the like of it. So on this, Ahmadi scholars should write articles. Your brother-in-law, tell him,
yes,
to write articles and publish them, and Jamaat Ahmadiyya should hold press conferences and support their views with the Quranic verses and the Sunnah, etc.
Inshallah.
There is so much substance to available in Ahmadiyya literature to support this cause that there's no reason why you should not take the frontal position in this. Make the spearhead of the attack against this stupid attitude attributed to Islam. And it is particularly for the sake of Islam. It's already poorly treated in the whole world. It's already misunderstood so much, unfortunately, that in some countries, there are times when this becomes, Islam becomes, is a target for hatred. Even in England, this happens. In Germany, everywhere. So these stupid mullahs, they don't know what they're doing. They're damaging the cause of Islam so much. On the one hand, there are efforts by Ahmadiyya Jamaat to convert the whole world into Islam. On the other hand, they quote these mullahs before us. They don't know the differences. How would they know that they also hate us and they are our enemies? But they represent Islam. As far as the rest of the world is concerned, they are the true representatives. Say, what are you, a small minority? Why should we listen to him? They know Islam, and this is their Islam, to destroy people, destroy opposition, to bend heads with force, to change opinions, with the help of whatever coercion is available to you, whatever coercion you can use to change the minds. Now, how can you change the minds with force and coercion?
Right.
See, heads can be bent, but not the wills. Wills are inside, They remain erect, and they cannot be changed. So you can destroy hearts, you can pierce hearts, but you cannot win hearts with coercion.
Right.
So that is what has to be highlighted in your struggle against these so-called orthodoxy. They're not orthodoxies. It's a misnomer to apply the word orthodoxy to them. But anyway, so the world understands them to be the custodians of Islam, the spokesmen of Islam, unfortunately. So it's for Bangladesh Jamaat to take up the cudgel in their hand, and to lead the movement against,
inshallah,
not the mullahs, against the misrepresentation of Islam. Remember this, that we do not believe in hating people. We believe in hating hatred. And they are spreading hatred. We hate that hatred,
Yes, not them.
Uh-huh. And among them also innocent, there are also innocent people.
Mm-hmm.
I think large-scale contact should also be made with the ulama. Because I know sometimes some ulama came to meet me, and they were very hostile. Their behavior was rather obnoxious. But after a few hours with me, discussing things, they completely changed. So Africa yes. stands first in the whole world in this.
Yes.
But after that, I think it's Bangladesh. Yes. The ulama can also change,
yes.
except for a few ones. You know, they are hardened ones, because there you have no hope, because Allah has declared that He has stamped, you know, their hearts and their ears, and there is a cover on their eyes. We can't know, can't say who is that, who that is, but Allah knows. But there are some people who would not change. It's impossible. Equal whether you make them draw their attention to God and try to make them fear Allah, or do not do it, they will remain the same. They are not going to accept faith.
Yes, Hazir. In Bangladesh, in the recent past, with your dua, some principals of madrasa and some ulemas have also accepted Ahmadiyya.
Yes, yes, I know.
Yes.
That's what I'm saying. I have high hopes.
Yes, inshallah.
Of not only the common man of Bangladesh, for which I have very deep respect, but also of ulemas. I know there is a section among them who is very obnoxious in their hostility and who can be dubbed as, you know, similar to those who have been described in the verses I've quoted. But a large number among the ulema, they are innocent people, very simple and true as well. They only hate you because the image that is painted to them of Ahmadiyya is really very, 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 let's say, if not, the least word is loathsome. I mean, once you see that picture yourself, even if you don't want to hate and oppose such things, such movements with force, loathsomeness is the word which comes to your mind. What a shocking thing, you know, how it disturbs your sensibilities. The Ahmadiyya they paint before the people is really loathsome. Once I told a mullah, I said, if this were Ahmadiyya, I would not change sides with you in the sense of trying to oppose Ahmadiyya with lies and all the false allegations, etc. But I could never love such a religion as you think it is. The minimum I could do would be that I would keep aloof. I said, no, nothing doing with this thing. But these people are not well trained in the discipline of Islam. They permit themselves to go to all excesses, all beyond all bounds. Whatever they can, they take up in their hands, as you said,
yes.
to even enforce law and order,
yes.
as they think it should be enforced. So let's pray and hope.
Yes. Okay. Huzur, kindly pray for such people in Bangladesh. Huzur, there is, when we go to preach about truth, and the generally Muslim friends raise the question, where is the mention of Imam Mahdi in Holy Quran, and how you...
You see, there is a mention of the of Imam Mahdi in the Holy Quran, but they don't see. Number one, it's very important for you and for everyone there in Bangladesh to remember that the one leading and the and principal verse relating to this issue is about Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ma yantiqu anil hawa in huwa illa wahyun yuha, that he never says a single word, never utters anything from his own. Whatever he says on the basis of wahi, on the, you know, based on the guidance of Allah. So if he has spoken so much and at such length about Imam Mahdi, and if, as we have seen, his prophecies have come to be fulfilled, bringing this additional proof of their truth, if they were invented or concocted by some false people, how could Allah see to it that they are fulfilled to the letter? How could He speak so much of Imam Mahdi while the Quran was empty of all this mention? So the Quran is full of the mention, full in the sense that it does mention very categorically, but these mullahs don't understand because they have their distorted views about Khatm al-Nubuwwat and this and that, and they interpret the verses of the Quran in a manner that their vision is obstructed with regards to some other verses as well. Now, I give you the example. The Holy Quran, at least in two places, mentions the names of many old prophets, produces a list of many prophets, and mentions none but the prophets of Allah. And to cap the relation, the narration, this verse is found at the end, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. All these prophets we have mentioned, what were they, what did they have in common? This was the question which was raised and which has been answered so beautifully and precisely. The Holy Quran says, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً, we made them imam, all of them. Remember one word, imam. Yahduna, they guide others, not from themselves, but first having been guided by us. Yahduna bi amrina, when we give them guidance, they guide. If we do not give them guidance, they stop short. So what is Imam Mahdi? Now tell me, it has two components.
Yes.
One is imam, appointed by God, correct?
Correct.
And the other is, he does not guide people from his own. Only when Allah guides him. That is Mahdi, the guided one.
Alhamdulillah.
So, what else do they want? According to the Holy Quran, this is the definition of prophethood. One of the definitions. Anyone who is appointed by God and guided by God, who does not say anything from himself, but only conveys to the people that which he hears from Allah, receives from Allah, and conveys only the guidance which he receives from the divine source, Allah. He, what would be his name? Al-Imam al-Mahdi. And they said there is no mention of that. Then they don't read Surah Jumu'ah, where an imam to come in the latter days is mentioned, you know, under what name? Under the name of Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course he would not come again, because he himself has explained this. But this is exactly what is written, literally taken. Surah Jumu'ah's message would be that Allah it is who raised Prophet Muhammad from amongst the illiterate people of, or unlettered people of Arabia, and he did this and that and that. And also among those, the same person, the same raising, also among those of some period who have not met them, who have not, who are unknown to these people. When would it happen? How would it happen? The verse, the style of the verse indicates as if Muhammad Rasulullah Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is going to come again. But when the question was raised to him, in answer to this, he said, you see, this verse was, these verses were revealed to him, and the way the hadith relates to this issue, it appears that they were revealed to him when he was in company, when there were some companions sitting around him. He received the verses and recited them. And one of the companions, in surprise, of course, inquired as to who these people are, they are mentioned. So what he said, the most important thing was that, in fact, it is not the people who are important. It is the person who is going to do something in that age. So also he said, Lokan al imano in the Suraya Lanalahu Rajulum min Haulai, putting his hand on the shoulder of Salman Farsi, the only non-Arab present in the company. Which means that if iman, faith, was lifted from the earth, it deserted earth and went to the Pleiades, you know, a cluster of stars, very, very brilliant stars. One of these would bring the faith back to the earth. And in some ahadith, some of these, not only one imam, but a few among them would bring. That will be a participation which will continue deep into the history. But I prefer the one version, because that speaks and pinpoints at Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam. So what name would you give to this imam? In the Holy Quran, the name is only Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know from his own account that it is not he himself in person who is going to come again. So if that is not Imam Mahdi, what he is? You know, are there three imams? One mentioned in the Quran without name, and two mentioned in the hadith by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the name of Imam Mahdi and Isa ibn Maryam. So if you do not relate Imam Mahdi to this verse, then you must believe that there are at least three imams. Because this hadith opens the possibility of others as well. So I said at least three imams. The ones mentioned in the hadith have titles. This imam has no title other than Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So which means that he will be a complete subservient imam, totally within the sway of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's teachings, not a step beyond. And he will give in so completely his own personality in, you know, to the overriding personality of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that nothing of his own will be left in him. Only then, and then only, can he be given metaphorically the name Muhammad, not otherwise. If he keeps something of his own, it's impossible for him to be declared Muhammad. It's like you see your image in the mirror. The person who is reflected in the image, he is the one, the first, the master. But the image is so much like it, it's also beautiful. Is it? I mean, somebody was fascinated at looking at the image. And some people who are beautiful, they themselves are fascinated, you know. And they look with wonder how God has created them. So that is how we love Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam. Not that he had his own beauty, but because he reflected his master, the supreme master, Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is how he's mentioned in the Quran. So whatever title you choose for him, he's mentioned in the Quran. And that is what you wanted.
Yes.
Right?
Alhamdulillah.
You got another point as well.
Good. Alhamdulillah. So shall we come to the now, the Quran and the love of the Quran, which you find in Hazrat Masih Maud sallallahu alaihi wasallam's writing, verse and poetry. If you search far and wide the entire history of Muslim poets, you will not find any poet who has said so much in love of the Quran. You hear Naats, of course.
Yes.
But one to have gone mad for the Quran, you know, and fallen in love head over heels, that is Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam. So would you kindly tell us, sing some verses?
Gandhaga.
چاند کیا پتہ زیادہ بتانے سے میں نے تو کہا کہ جمال اس نے قرآن کے پورا رکھنا تھا چل چلے آل رائٹ
Jamal-o-Husn-e-Quran Noor-e-Jan har musalma hai.
Absolutely fascinating.
Jamal-o-Husn-e-Quran Noor-e-Jan har musalma hai. Kamar hai chando aro ka hamara chan Qur'an hai. Kamar hai chand aro ka hamara chand Qur'an hai. Jamal-o-Husn-e-Quran-noor-e-jaan-e-har-musalmaan-hai. Kamar hai chand aaron ka hamara chand Qur'an hai. Nazir uski nahi jamti, nazar mein fikr kar dekha. Bhala kyo karna ho yakta, kalam-e-paak rehman nazir ne nazir uski nahi jamti nazar mein fikr kar dekha bhala kyon karna ho yakta kalam-e-paak rehman hai Bahar-e-Zabeda paida hai uski har barat mein Nab-o-Khob-e-Chaman mein hai na usa koi busta hai Bahar-e-Zabeda paida hai uski har ibarat mein nab-o-khob-e-chaman mein hai na usa koi busta hai khuda ke kolo se kole bashar kyun kar barabar ho वहां कुदरत यहां दरमंद ही
फर्क-ए
नमाया है खुदा के कोलों से कोले बशर क्यों कर बराबर हो वहाँ कुदरत यहाँ दरमंदगी फर्क न माया है बना सकता नहीं एक पाँव किरे का बशर हरगिज़ तो फिर क्यों कर बनाना नूरे हक्का उस पे आसान है Jamal-o-Husn-e-Quran-noor-e-jaan-e-har-musalmaan-hai kamar hai chand aaron ka hamara chand Qur'an hai Jamal-o-Husn-e-Quran-noor-e-jaan-e-har-musalmaan-hai kamar hai chand aaron ka hamara chand quran hai.
You should remember the whole poem by heart.
So I got the whole poem. I wrote it.
I know, but your poem is either in your pocket or in your bags.
Yes. Yes.
I want to put it in your heart and in your mind.
Eh? Ho jayega.
Memorize it fully.
It will be done.
I didn't realize that. I have to sing.
You didn't realize that your voice was so charming. And Masih Maud Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's kalam in your voice, you know, just overwhelms oneself. Absolutely. Becomes irresistible. With the help of music, you know, you begin to understand the meaning more clearly.
Mm-hmm.
So it brings out the hidden beauties
from the soul.
You know, from hidden beauties of the verses, and opens them up before your avijan and before your heart, and there's no sort of, you know, any screen left in between.
Yes, actually, it's one. When we are going to do this sort of thing, I think, especially that I go in a different world, and which is
exactly
yes.
You yourself, one could see from your expressions,
yes,
that you are yourself transported,
yes,
transcended. While you were reading it, your heart was in it, and this is the beauty of singing a poem, that the singer's heart should be totally lost in the subject. In the substance of the poem. And he should be taken over, carried over, as if one is being tossed on the waves, on the crest of the waves. And he's no more him or his own self. And that is how you sing, and that is why it looks so charming.
Actually, we collect six nazam. Nazm opashwa.
Have you got another one?
No, not
no. I think
I have got another one.
Another.
Let's have it.
Fun.
Already we did record this one.
No, but I want to hear it from you yourself.
A few verses.
A few minutes. For a few minutes. Mm-hmm. We have Saeed Zafar Saeb. We have time, haven't we?
We've got another 5 minutes.
Okay.
We'll take it, inshallah.
But take your time. Don't bother about the 5 minutes.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Alhamdulillah.
Sundarban people will be enjoying it, also others, you know, in Ahmadnagar.
Yes.
And Panchagar also there is.
Panchagar is Ahmadnagar.
That's right.
And Chittagong.
And Chittagong and Narayanganj.
And Khulna.
Dhaka, Chorbakshi Bazaar and Khulna, of course. And there's so many places.
And some houses also, yes. Huzur, by now.
Who have done,
yes.
Who have got their
private dish.
Private antennas, yes. Bogra, there's.
Maybe. Yeah.
So. Okay, please.
Noor-e-Furqan Hay Jo. Sab nooro se. Ajla nikla pak wo jisse ye anwar ka darya nikla noore furqa hai jo sab nooro se ajla nikla pak o jisse anwar ka darya nikla noore furqa hai jo sab nooro se ajla nikla haq ki tauhid ka murjha hi chala tha pauda nagha gab se ye chashmaye asfa nikla haq ki tauhid ka
murjhai chala tha pauda nagaha gab se ye chashmaaye asfaan nikla noor-e-furqan hay jo sab nooro se ajla nikla ya ilahi tera furqan hay ke ek alam hai jo zaruri tha wo sab isme muhayya nikla ya ilahi tera furqan hai ke ek alam hai jo zaruri tha wo sab isme muhayya nikla noor-e-furqan hay jo sab nooro se ajla nikla pak o jisse anwaar ka darya nikla noor-e-furqan hay jo sab nooro se ajla nikla
jazakumullah excellent mashallah very inspiring and elevating I think it's time for us to call it a day now although the 1 hour we spent together somehow has passed so quickly I am surprised you know only in a matter of minutes the whole hour was over so inshallah we'll meet again
inshallah.
Because I think we should have more such meetings
yes
addressing Bangladesh and addressing Bangladeshi questions and so on the things which are agitating their minds should be brought up by Bengalis themselves and we'll take them up inshallah
yes.
So with that I think we take leave of the viewers and audience on your behalf on behalf of Imam Sahib London Mosque and myself I take leave of you all assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah and Bangladesh zindabad how do you say zindabad in Bangladeshi language
zindabad zindabad
instead of zinda you say just zinda
come on
Bangladesh zindabad and Islam zindabad and Ahmadiyya Islam in Bangladesh zindabad assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah